Let's talk about the electrical event of the heart. The heart has the electrical event and the mechanical event. So today let's talk about the electrical one, and then we're going to talk about the mechanical. And after we covered both, eventually we're going to talk about the Wiggers diagram. So your job is to understand how this works. So let's get started. To talk about the electrical event, the electrical trigger mechanical. It's like the car. When you grab your car key, you work to your car, the first signal comes from the battery. So if your battery dies, it happens a lot in Texas because the summer is so hot. If your battery dies, your car is completely quiet. Nothing happened. And when you call AAA, they will ask you, do you see the signal? Do you see the line? Do you hear the radio? And if the answer is oh no, and they will say probably it's a battery, they will send the battery car to help you. So the electrical events need to trigger the mechanical. Mechanical is the engine operation, and the heart is the same. So those electrical events gonna trigger the heart, mechanical events, the contraction. That's the engine part. And eventually we care about the engine. We care about you have a Ferrari engine or just have a Toyota Corona's engine. It's the engine part, but the electrical signal need to trigger it. So those electrical events need to trigger at the molecular level. That's this. So those muscle fiber, they need to have muscle contraction. So we're going to explain the muscle contraction. And when I look at the whole book, this is the funny part. I could not find the mechanical events of the molecular, explain the molecular muscle contraction of the cardiac muscle. So I have to go to use the skeletal muscle. This is skeletal muscle's model to explain how the cardiac muscle work. But that's fine. And the reason is, I said there are a lot of similarities between the skeletal muscle and the cardiac muscle because they both are able to generate a big power. So their structure are very similar. And the cardiac muscle is more advanced muscle. So it has all the advantage of the skeletal muscle, but it does not have the shortcoming of skeletal muscle. So you won't have muscle fatigue, you won't have muscle cramp. So we're going to use the skeletal muscle's muscle molecular model to explain how the cardiac muscle work. And well, eventually we're going to compare both. So it's okay, we start to talk about skeletal muscle. Now let's look at the skeletal muscle. Skeletal muscle at the molecular level, you have those they call the sarcomere. Sarcomere is like a unit. You have the thick filament and thin filament, and overlap is the overlapping model. So when the muscle contraction happens, it's like the gliding window. If you think about the gliding the gliding door in the bathroom, they just overlap more, and the whole sarcomere becomes shorter. When the sarcomere becomes shorter, the whole muscle that are made of a lot of sarcomere, they become shorter. So when the muscle contraction happens, the physical distance of the muscle becomes shorter. And the muscle connect to bones through tendon. So when the muscle contraction happens, it's going to pull a bone closer to the other bone. That's how they create movement. So at the molecular level, this is the whole sarcomere. You have the thick filament and the thin filament. And if you take anatomy, you learned, okay, this is the A-band. A-band is the ones they look dark under the microscope. And this one they call the I-band. And when the muscle contraction happens, the I-band becomes shorter because it's an overlapping model. So the thin filament and thin filament, they come closer. So the I-band becomes shorter. That's how the contraction happens. And the thick filaments is made of myosin. Myosin is the protein. It's a protein. And the thin filaments have three. So it's mainly made of actin. So let's look at actin first. Those cranberries, they're actin. Actin and myosin, these two proteins, they naturally want to glue together. In the lab, if you create a test tube of actin, it's transparent. And another test tube solution of myosin is also transparent. When you pull these two together, you start to see the white precipitation because these two protein they naturally want to glue together. They're like a magnet. So it's perfect for these two, one to create a thick filament, one create a thin filament. But you have a problem because if you only have these two, your muscle gonna contract all the time. You're like zombies. You never rest. So you need to have I call it duct tape, tripomycin, to block the binding site of actin. It's like you have two strong magnets. Now you put a few pieces of paper to separate them. So they still attach, but now they're weak. And you can have muscle relaxation. So the tripomycin, its function is block the binding site of actin. So you can have muscle relaxation. The myosin is still hanging there, And now your muscle is totally relaxed. You still want to have a mechanism to be able to pull those tape, those paper away, and the actin and the myosin can have a strong magnet and trigger them strong muscle contraction. So you need to have a sensor to sense the signal. And the sensor is called a troponin. Troponin is actually three proteins. It's called the troponin complex. We won't go to that much detail, so you just say the troponin. Troponin is a sensor. And the signal to trigger muscle contraction is calcium. So when the calcium comes, when we talk about the second messenger, I told you calcium is also the second messenger. And you learned in the neuron, calcium is the one to trigger neurotransmitter release. Now in the muscle, calcium is the one to trigger muscle contraction. And that's why in the intracellular level, the calcium concentration is almost zero, because calcium is the second messenger. And when you have enough calcium, they're going to do something. So the calcium is pretty low inside the cell. And the calcium in the muscle is going to bind with troponin. When the calcium binds with troponin, it's going to make the tripomyosin shine away, and actin and myosin, like two strong magnets, they're going to glue together, and they're going to cause the muscle contraction. So that's the molecular mechanism of muscle contraction. And you found, well, there's no ATP yet, right? I haven't talked about the ATP, yeah. So to start from the start the muscle contraction, so far you don't need ATP, you only need calcium. So the dead animal body, they can have muscle contraction. Look at if you like CSI, you found those, the dead body, they are rigid. The reason is they all have muscle contraction, but they could not have muscle relaxation. Why? Because to trigger muscle relaxation, you need to have ATP. So far, when the calcium comes, calcium binds with troponin, tripomyosin shine away, actin and myosin, strong, like two strong magnets, they glue together. Muscle contraction part, no ATP. But if you want the head detach, it's like two strong magnets, they glue together, you want to separate them, you need to give them energy. So that's when the ATP kick in. So ATP will cause the detachment. And think about the muscle contraction sequence. It's a sequence of muscle attach and they become shorter, then you need to detach and bind them again, they're gonna overlap more and more. So it's a sequence of muscle contraction and relaxation. And when the muscle for the muscle to work properly, you need to have calcium, you also need to have ATP. That's why for the muscle physiology, ATP is very important. But if you want to separate the whole mechanism into two parts, calcium trigger muscle contraction, ATP is for muscle relaxation. And for the muscle to work properly, these sequences need to keep going. So they need to come from the cross bridge. They call this cross bridge. And when they bind, they call the power stroke. The head of the myosin is going to move a little bit. So it's like the gliding door, they overlap more. And then you need to detach them. So the detachment part requires ATP. And they just keep going through this process. So the muscle can overlap more and more and more contraction. And that's the video. I'll leave them to you. I'll show you the power stroke, the molecular mechanism. And the signal to ask muscle contraction come from your brain, your motor cortex. So through the motor cortex, you're gonna signal the neurons gonna go to your spinal cord. Most of them go to the spinal cord. And the spinal cord in the ventral, right? So the ventral horn, that's the motor neuron located through the ventral horn, and the axon go out. Now it go to the peripheral tissue, muscle, skeletal muscle. So in this area, those motor neurons release acetylcholine, that's the neurotransmitter. And we talk about this part in the autonomic nervous system, because when we compare the autonomic nervous system with the skeletal muscle, the motor neurons, this area called the motor end plate. This skeletal muscle need to quickly pick up the signal from the motor neuron, because that's when you see a bear coming towards you. You want to use your whole body muscle to run away from the bear. So they need to quickly pick up the signal from the neuron. And on the cell membrane of skeletal muscle, they have a lot of nicotinic acetylcholine receptor within there. So in this area, they call the motor end plate. Motor end plate is part of the skeletal muscle cell membrane. They call it sarcolemma. That's the cell muscle membrane. And the signal comes from the motor neuron. So the motor neuron is going to send the signal acetylcholine to the motor end plate. And when it binds with nicotinic acetylcholine receptor, which is a non-selective cation receptor. So when they open, sodium can flow in, potassium can flow out. It's a non-selective. And it turns out the sodium flow in is much faster than the potassium flow out. So when they open the nicotinic acetylcholine receptor, the end result is depolarization. So the motor end plate, you have a depolarization. They call the end plate potential. Very similar to the gradient potential when we talk about the neuron. And it's a gradient potential, so you won't be able to travel for a long distance. You learn the concept in neurons, so your concept keep building up. You need to generate action potential. Only action potential can travel for a long distance. So when we go out of the motor end plate, you actually have a lot of voltage-gated sodium and voltage-gated potassium channel waiting there. So now the signal, the end plate potential, transfer to action potential. It triggers the action potential. And the action potential can keep going. It's like the action potential in the neuron, it goes through the whole axon. And now the action potential goes through this tube called T-tubule. T-tubule are those tube structure. They are perpendicular to all the muscle fiber. Its job is quickly transfer, it's like the axon in the neuron, quickly transfer all the action potential to all the fiber. Because you don't want only the surface muscle fiber receive the signal and muscle contraction, and the inside, the deep part, have muscle relaxation. You want the whole muscle to contract together to deal with emergency situation. And this is the T-tubule's function. T-tubule is to transfer all the action potential. It's perpendicular to all the fibers, so it can transfer all the action potential to every fiber. On the T-tubule, he has a DHP receptor. It's very unique. You only find it in the T-tubule. And the DHP is a receptor. It sends the voltage, connect with the RYR. RYR is like a gate. It's a receptor on the SR. What's SR? SR is the ER, endoplasmic reticulum in every cell. But in the muscle, it's called SR, sarcoplasmic. So every time you see the sarco, you know it's muscle. It's SR. And in the muscle, their SR become the calcium container. Because you need the calcium to trigger muscle contraction. You need a lot of calcium. But you cannot let the calcium flow inside the muscle in the cytosol. It's gonna trigger muscle contraction. It's the second messenger. So you need to have the calcium, a lot of calcium, and you could not let them stay in the cytosol. You keep them in the SR. So it's the calcium container. When the signal goes through the T-tubule, you're gonna activate DHP, gonna open the RYR. When they open, calcium flow out. And once the calcium flow out, okay, we learn this part. Calcium gonna bind with troponin. When it bind with troponin, triple myosin shine away. When the triple myosin shine away, acting the myosin like a too strong magnet, muscle contraction happen. And after muscle contraction, calcium need to be pumped back. So you have the calcium pump on the SR, they can quickly remove the calcium. And when the calcium pump back, muscle relaxation. And either this cycle keep going if you keep exercising, or it go back when you relax your muscle. So that's, they call it EC coupling, excitation contraction coupling. Because of calcium, the electrical signal. So you found those neurotransmitter release, action potential, electrical signal, transfer to the contraction, those mechanical events, because now you have those microfiber, myofibril, they start to have contraction, mechanical events. So EC coupling, what's EC coupling? It explains how the electrical signal being transferred into the mechanical event. The real, you can see the muscle, you can see the muscle contraction happen. And the signal, the second messenger is calcium. Okay, let's take a short break.